Good morning.
Good morning, Carol.
Good morning. Oh, you quiet down so much faster than my elementary school kids. We start with announcements just before we start our program. So we have announcements on the back of your order of service. Don't forget, I peeked in at the Tombaugh Gallery this morning. They've got some gorgeous paintings in there, drawings. The church office will be closed tomorrow, don't forget. The library hours are on your paper. Important, next Sunday is Flower Communion, and it's the 100th anniversary of the Flower Communion in UU churches. So it's being called the Flower Ceremony Centennial. So be sure to bring some flowers, and we'll share them. Reverend Nancy and Charlie will be in charge of that program, right? Don't forget the Juneteenth banquet. Talk to Jan about that. The details are here. June 17th. And mindfulness practice. Reba is organizing that at the Good Samaritan, 3:30 to 4:30 on Tuesdays and Thursdays. So the details are there. Any other announcements? I think that's it. So we'll start. Do you have an announcement? Okay.
Tell her to take the microphone.
Can you come up to the mic? Or no, I could bring you a mic. Okay. Let's do that. Forgot we had a mic to carry.
I am. Is it on? Okay. This coming Saturday, I am having a very large yard sale, and I want you to know that the queen of pillowcases is selling out her stuff because I can't possibly move it. I'm going to, it's going to have fabric, and finished items, and unfinished quilts, and it's going to be mostly fabric stuff for this time. And I'm looking for about four or five people to help. You can talk to me after church, and those who help get to come the day before and do their shopping.
All right, June 2nd for helpers, June 3rd for the sale. Thank you, Chris.
Good. And we'll begin today with our special musicians called Old Time Pharmaceuticals. Blowing in the Wind.
Washed to the sea.
Yes, and how many years can some people exist before they're allowed to be free? Yes, and how many times can a man turn his head and pretend that he just doesn't see? Blowing in the wind, the answer is blowing in the wind. Must a man look up before he can see the sky? Yes, and how many ears must one man have before he can hear people cry? Yes, and how many deaths will it take till he knows that too many people have died? The answer, my friends, is blowing in the wind. The answer is blowing in the wind. The answer, my friends, is blowing in the wind. The answer is blowing in the wind.
Now, can you hear me? I'd like to welcome you to the Unitarian Universalist Church of Las Cruces. I'm Carol Stanfill, and I'll be your service associate today. We'd like to welcome each and every person as you join us in our beautiful sanctuary or via YouTube. Our service leader today is Katie Fitzgerald. And we're delighted to have special guest musicians, Old Time Pharmaceutical. And of course, it takes a village, so helping our broadcast via the internet, we have Elwin Nunn on the camera. Thank you. Claire Wallace on audio. Michael Yaksko is our technician. Big job. Thanks, guys. Hospitality today will be provided by the Social Justice Committee, and that's right down the breezeway after church. The greeters, thank you, are Mark Sikontarek, Kathy Cox, and Jillian Ling. Thanks to all these folks and many others that keep our church running smoothly, we're delighted to be with you today. Unitarian Universalism is a religion that has no dogma, no creed. We're a covenant-based church. This means we agree to live in relationship with each other according to our UU principles and our church's covenant of right relations. We embrace diversity in all its forms. Everyone who is in agreement with these principles is welcome in our church. You can learn more about the church and the Unitarian Universalism on the internet at uua.org. or uuchurchlc.org, or just Google it. If you're visiting us today, we would like to meet you. When I bring the mic to you, will you introduce yourself and tell us where you're from? Are there any visitors in the sanctuary today? Good. Are you visiting today?
Yes.
Good. Judy.
Right. I am one of Betty's neighbors. Okay. And she's been after me.
Is this on?
Church.
Okay. Eat the microphone.
Oh.
Let me hold it close to you.
Okay. Gosh, I should sing or something.
Okay. later.
Anyway, my name is Judy Nunn, and I live in Trails West. And, I've been here about 14 years now. Mm. Moved down here, or over here from Tucson, and I've made a really nice group of friends, and I really like it. But I don't go to church, so I'm not going to lie, I do not go to church. So, and it isn't that I don't want to, it's just that I'm lazy.
That's why we have YouTube.
I know. So anyway, thank you for letting me come and visit you today.
Good. Welcome. And this is a good church for folks that don't go to church.
Hi, I'm Wendell Smith. I'm Reba Montero's son. I'm visiting here from Pennsylvania, just hanging out with my mom.
And if you're visiting, I see a hand.
I'd like to introduce Susan, my friend, and she's a good friend, and she was a UU many, many, many years ago for many, many years. Stand up.
I must fall down.
You've been a UU. Where were you, UU?
In Santa Fe.
Oh, okay. And we may have visitors on YouTube. Welcome. If you're in the sanctuary and you'd like to be added to our correspondence list, there are little cards tucked in the back of the chairs for information. So if you fill one of those out and give it to either a greeter or me, or put it in the offering plate, we'll put you on our list. Unitarian Universalism has many different interpretations of the flaming chalice, including the light of reason, the warmth of community, or the flame of hope. Most UU churches begin with our lighting of the chalice. We'll do that today with these words from Melanie Davis. She's coordinator of OWL, which is just O-W-L, which stands for Our Whole Lives. And we're gonna be hopefully starting that in our church with young people very soon. She wrote, "If ever there were a time for a candle in the darkness, this would be it. Using a spark of hope, kindle the flame of love, ignite the light of peace, and feed the flame of justice." Please join me as we recite the covenant for our church, the affirmation of covenant, and we'll follow it by singing our UU doxology in English and Spanish. Love is the doctrine of our church. The quest for truth is a sacrament, and service is our prayer. To dwell together in peace, to seek knowledge in freedom, to serve others in community, to the end that all souls shall grow into harmony with the creation. Thus do we covenant with one another.
From all that dwell below the skies, let songs of hope and faith arise. Let peace, goodwill on earth be sung. Through every land, by every tongue,
Kelly is our RE director, takes wonderful care of our young people.
happy sunny Sunday. This morning I will be reading What's Going On. Mother, mother, there's too many of you crying. Brother, 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 there's far too many of you dying. You know we've got to find a way to bring some love in here today. Yeah. Father, father, we don't need to escalate. You see, war is not the answer, for only love can conquer hate. You know we've got to find a way to bring some love in here today. Picket lines and picket signs. Don't punish me with brutality. Talk to me so you can see. Oh, what's going on? What's going on? Mother, mother, everybody thinks we're wrong. Oh, but who are they to judge us simply because our hair is long? You know, we've got to find a way to bring some understanding here today. Picket lines and picket signs. Don't punish me with brutality. Come on, talk to me so you can see what's going on. What's going on? Thank you.
Okay. All right. We're not singing you out today because we don't have a piano on. I'm sorry for that. Those words, many of you know, of 1974, Marvin Gaye's What's Going On. Please rise in body or spirit and join in the opening hymn, Where Have All the Flowers Gone? by Pete Seeger.
Time.
is gone, gone to graveyards, everyone. When will they ever learn? When will they ever learn? Where have all the graveyards gone? Long time passing.
The time in our service where we share our joys, sorrows, and milestones, or light a candle as we quietly reflect upon the same. Today, Carol and I are asking you, as our beloved community, we know how important it is that we share moments of delight as well as despair. But we're asking you to stretch beyond the walls of this sanctuary and to find beloved community in a larger sense, even beyond the state of New Mexico, to the boundaries of our country. And as part of our memorial observance this morning, she and I will read the sites of all of the mass shootings that have occurred in our country since the beginning of this year, to honor those innocents who have fallen.
January 1st. In Allentown, Pennsylvania.
Chicago, Illinois.
Durham, North Carolina.
Clinton, Maryland.
Ocala, Florida.
Oklahoma City, Oklahoma.
Mifflintown, Ohio.
January 3rd, New Orleans, Louisiana.
Washington, D.C.
January 4th, Enoch, Utah.
Baltimore, Maryland.
Dumfries, Virginia.
January 5th, New Orleans, Louisiana.
Miami Gardens, Florida.
January 6, San Francisco, California.
Dallas, Texas.
January 7, Huntsville, Alabama.
Lee Township, Michigan.
High Point, North Carolina.
January 8, Albany, Georgia.
Minneapolis, Minnesota.
January 9, Minneapolis, Minnesota.
Philadelphia, Pennsylvania.
Denver, Colorado.
On January 13, Cleveland, Ohio.
January 15th, Houston, Texas.
Rockford, Illinois.
Phoenix, Arizona.
Homestead, Florida.
January 16th, Sanford, Florida.
Fort Pierce, Florida.
January 6th, Goshen, California.
January 17th in Houston, Texas.
January 18th, Lynchburg, Virginia.
January 21 to 22, Monterey Park, California.
Tunica Resorts, Mississippi.
Shreveport, Louisiana.
Brookhaven, Georgia.
Baton Rouge, Louisiana.
January 23rd, Oakland, California.
Half Moon Bay, California.
Chicago, Illinois.
Dodge City, Kansas.
January 24th, Robeson County, North Carolina.
On January 26th, Newark, New Jersey.
Lancaster, Pennsylvania.
Andrews, South Carolina.
January 28th, Austin, Texas.
Philadelphia, Pennsylvania.
Los Angeles, California.
On January 29th, Greensboro, North Carolina.
January 30th, Lakeland, Florida.
Dallas, Texas.
January 31st, Durham, North Carolina. In the month of January, 87 lives lost. We will remember you.
In February 1st, Los Angeles, California. In Texas City, Texas. February 4th.
Huntsville, Texas.
Stockton, California.
Tucson, Arizona.
Newport, Arkansas.
Falcon, Colorado.
On February 6th, Corpus Christi, Texas.
February 8th, Laurinburg, North Carolina.
New Orleans, Louisiana.
Elizabeth City, North Carolina.
February 9th, Harvey, Louisiana.
New York City, New York.
February 12th, Louisville, Mississippi.
February 13th, East Lansing, Michigan.
February 13th, Patterson, New Jersey.
February 14th, Buffalo, New York.
And Sweetwater, Tennessee.
Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania.
In Baltimore, Maryland.
El Paso, Texas.
On the 17th, Columbus, Georgia.
February 18th, Columbus, Georgia.
Galena Park, Texas.
Horry County, South Carolina.
On the 19th, Chicago, Illinois.
New Orleans, Louisiana.
Linden, New Jersey.
St. Louis, Missouri.
Memphis, Tennessee.
February 19th, Indianapolis, Indiana.
And on February 20th, Cantagno, Puerto Rico.
February 21st, Colorado Springs, Colorado.
On the 22nd, Pine Hills, Florida.
February 23rd, Philadelphia, Pennsylvania.
February 25th, St. Paul, Minnesota.
West Palm Beach, Florida.
McChesney Park, Illinois.
Pompano Beach, Florida.
On the 26th, Memphis, Tennessee.
Detroit, Michigan.
27th, New Richmond, Ohio.
Memphis, Tennessee. In the month of February, 54 lives lost.
These will be remembered.
March 1st, Kansas City, Missouri.
And Cocoa Beach, Florida.
Camp Girardeau, Missouri.
On the 4th, Douglasville, Georgia.
Los Angeles, California.
Lake City, Florida.
Bolingbrook, Illinois.
Shreveport, Louisiana.
Memphis, Tennessee.
La Riviera, California.
Memphis, Tennessee.
Los Angeles, California.
March 8th, Pine Bluff, Arkansas.
And on the 10th, Miami Lakes, Florida.
Dallas, Texas on the 12th.
Lubbock, Texas.
March 14th, Birmingham and St. Clair County in Alabama.
March 15th, Modesto, California.
March 18th, Columbus, Ohio.
And Chicago, Illinois.
Dallas, Texas.
March 20th, Milwaukee, Wisconsin.
March 21st, Trenton, New Jersey.
Sumter, South Carolina.
March 23rd, Baltimore, Maryland.
March 25th, Williamston, North Carolina.
March 25th, Shreveport, Louisiana.
Philadelphia, Pennsylvania.
March 26th, Little Rock, Arkansas.
Hempstead, New York.
Minden, Louisiana.
Brooklyn Center, Minnesota.
March 27th, Nashville, Tennessee.
And Milwaukee, Wisconsin.
And March 29th, Memphis, Tennessee. In the month of March, lives lost, 55. April 1st, two incidents in Oklahoma City, Oklahoma. Los Angeles, California. Baltimore, Maryland. April 2nd, Fayetteville, North Carolina. Washington, D.C. Moreno Valley, California. Jackson, Tennessee. April 3rd, Atlanta, Georgia.
And Pueblo, Colorado.
April 4th, Philadelphia, Pennsylvania.
April 5th, Virginia Beach, Virginia.
Kansas City, Kansas.
April 6th, Philadelphia, Pennsylvania.
April 7th, Isle of Palms in South Carolina.
And New Orleans, Louisiana.
Park Forest, Illinois.
April 8th, Houston, Texas.
April 9th, Orlando, Florida.
April 10th, Louisville, Kentucky.
Guayama, Puerto Rico.
April 11th, Washington, D.C.
April 12th, Toledo, Ohio.
Fort Wayne, Indiana.
Goldsboro, North Carolina.
Trenton, New Jersey.
April 13th, New York City, New York.
And Houston, Texas.
Detroit, Michigan.
Bridgeport, Connecticut.
Kansas City, Missouri on April 14th.
April 15th, Dadeville, Alabama.
Louisville, Kentucky.
Los Angeles, California.
Detroit, Michigan.
April 16th, Maui, Hawaii.
And Biloxi, Mississippi.
The 17th, Baltimore, Maryland.
Houston, Texas.
The 18th, Bowdoin and Yarmouth, Maine.
April 20th, Hartford, Connecticut.
April 21st, Washington, D.C.
And Rockmart, Georgia.
April 22nd, Winston-Salem, North Carolina.
April 23rd, San Francisco, California.
Jasper County, Texas.
April 28th, Philadelphia, Pennsylvania.
And San Jacinto County in Texas.
April 29th, Auburn, Washington.
And Columbia, South Carolina.
April 30th, Athens, Georgia.
Paducah, Kentucky.
Lawrence, Massachusetts.
Mojave, California.
Bay St. Louis, Mississippi. At the end of April, the total, 62 lives lost. All these lives lost.
All will be remembered.
May 1st, Henrietta, Oklahoma. May 2nd, DeKalb County, Georgia.
And Lake Wells, Florida.
May 3rd, Chicago, Illinois.
And Atlanta, Georgia.
May 5th, San Diego, California.
Natchez, Mississippi.
Vicksburg, Mississippi.
St. Louis, Mississippi.
Ocean Springs, Mississippi.
And Bastrop, Louisiana.
May 6th, Columbus, Ohio.
Allen, Texas.
Chico, California.
May 10th, Denver, Colorado.
May 11th, Chicago, Illinois.
Indianapolis, Indiana.
Philadelphia, Pennsylvania.
May 13th, Dallas, Texas.
May 13th, August, Georgia.
Manchester, New Hampshire.
Shreveport, Louisiana.
Sacramento, California.
Yuma, Arizona.
Louisville, Kentucky.
Shreveport, Louisiana.
May 14th, Anderson, Indiana.
Montgomery, Alabama.
Hazleton, Pennsylvania.
Farmington, New Mexico.
San Antonio, Texas.
Kansas City, Kansas.
May 18th, San Antonio, Texas.
May 20th, Los Angeles, California.
And Thompson, Georgia.
Louisville, Kentucky.
New Orleans, Louisiana.
Clarksdale, Mississippi.
And Kent, Washington.
LaForche Parish in Louisiana.
May 21, Kansas City, Missouri.
Columbus, Indiana.
Columbia, Tennessee.
May 23rd, Nash, Texas.
Baltimore, Maryland.
May 26th, Dale City, Virginia.
Baltimore, Maryland.
Country Club Estates, Georgia.
Milwaukee, Wisconsin.
For the month of May, 72 lives lost. You will be remembered. And now, for all the joys, all the sorrows that we as individuals carry in our hearts, but have not as yet named, I will light this candle. If you would now turn to number 577 in the hymnal, we have a little bit of audience participation, otherwise known as a responsive reading. You get to read the part in italics, and I'll read the plain text. The title is, It Is Possible to Live in Peace. If someone with courage and vision can rise to lead in nonviolent action, the winter of our despair can, in the twinkling of an eye, be turned into the summer of hope.
It is possible to live in peace.
Nonviolence is not a garment to put on and off at will. Its seat is in the heart, and it must be an inseparable part of our being.
It is possible to live in peace.
Nonviolence, which is a quality of the heart, cannot come by an appeal to the brain. It is a plant of slow growth, growing imperceptibly but surely.
It is possible to live in peace.
If a single person achieves the highest kind of love, it will be sufficient to neutralize the hate of millions.
It is possible to live in peace.
If we are to reach real peace in this world, and if we are to carry on a real war against war, we shall have to begin with the children.
It is possible to live in peace.
The future depends on what we do in the present.
It is possible to live in peace.
Mahatma Mohandas Gandhi, no surprise. I brought my own little visual aid. Where have all the flowers gone? And I have to admit that the lyrics of Where Have All the Flowers Gone, and as we sung it today, are not very UU. And I apologize, I didn't think about that. I could have done a rewrite, but I hope you'll forgive me. My homily this morning has three parts. The first is to pay my respects to fallen soldiers as part of our Memorial Day remembrance. I have the deepest respect for those who have sacrificed their lives for our country and for our community. I use the last phrase to include first responders along with those who've served in the armed forces. I also pay my respects to the families, the spouses, the grandparents, the children, the parents who support and who grieve their loss. I honor too, along with the fallen, those who have returned from the ravages of war, broken in mind, body, or spirit. And all of this is in keeping with our first principle. I hope that we all will take the opportunity tomorrow and every day to honor the fallen, all the victims of war. Next comes the second part. I entitled my remarks this morning, Where Have All the Flowers Gone? And those of you familiar with that song know that it's circular and implies that everything happens in a pattern to which there will be no end. The inevitability of flowers going to young girls and young girls going to soldiers, and soldiers going to war and dying and coming home and being buried and new life springing up in the form of flowers, and the whole thing goes all over again and again. A cycle of war that seems like it never ends. But for me, when I think about this song and when I speak about flowers today, I'm using the word in place of innocence or perhaps trust. Where has my innocence gone? I think back to a time when I was probably six. My dad and brothers and I went to the movies at the drive-in to see Wings of Eagles. It's a John Wayne classic about a Navy hero who fell on leave and was paralyzed. John Wayne's character struggles to overcome his paralysis just in time to enter World War II and take command of a Navy destroyer. Later in the movie, his ship comes under fire. He is wounded and he needs to be removed from his command and from his ship. Even at this young age, I understood for this warrior, service was his life. And in this moment, his life as he defined it was over. I cried buckets, buckets, so much that my brothers teased me about being the Pacific Ocean. But also in that moment, the first petal of innocence was lost. A few years later, again getting ready for a trip to the drive-in, we're popping popcorn, getting the sodas chilled, but my mom was subdued, not quite as ebullient as she normally was, and I asked her what was on her mind. She told me that the news broadcast that evening had some troubling news. The United States was taking some action in the area of Vietnam, and it was of concern to her. She had four sons, I have four brothers, all of whom were of an age to be drafted if this thing escalated in the way that she thought it might. I had no knowledge or thinking of that, and so from that moment, I started to consider what our lives as a family would be like if any or all of my brothers were called to serve. Second petal, gone. After that, I began to pay more attention to the nightly news, essentially the Vietnam War highlights brought to us in living color in our living room by Walter Cronkite. The third petal withered slowly away as I watched these broadcasts night after night, and then heard fellow students talk about how the war profited big business. Much later, I was in college, attending one of the branch campuses of The Ohio State University. Going to class just as I did any normal day, I got to the second floor and on the wall was a hand-drawn picture. Four drops of red paint in a vertical line, and underneath it, the lettering said, "Four Lives Lost at KSU," calling to mind the recent protest at Kent State University and the four protesters who perished from being shot at by the National Guard troops under the command of then-Governor James Rhodes. Fourth petal, gone. A few months later, three friends and I went to Columbus, the capital of the state, where we were planning to move to the main campus for the rest of our college career, and we wanted to share an apartment. I came from a very small town, farm town, and I lived a very sheltered life in many ways. I was always prim and proper, did what I was supposed to do, colored within the lines, never broke any law, never, never, never did anything to upset my parents in any way. Really, straight and narrow down the line. So going to the big city was a new and scary experience for me, and I think for my friends. As we started our apartment hunt and got to the campus, there was a barrier and an armed guard. He asked us our business, and we told him what we were about, and he told us we could go no further, and we might as well turn around and go back home. There was no business to be had by anyone that day, and he could see no point in us being there. The campus was closed to anyone who did not have the proper identification. Indeed, the campus and the whole surrounding neighborhood had over it a cloud that was slowly dissipating. It was a cloud from the tear gas used the night before to dispel dissenters, protesters, demonstrators, call them what you will. Fifth petal lost. Okay, well, fast forward decades. We've been through wars since that time, war, police action, whatever you want to call it. And as a school administrator, I was in a position to have students of mine go into the armed forces. When I could, I became Facebook friends with them to generally keep an eye out and stay in tune with what was going on with them. There was a former student, Sean. I loved that kid. And I was sorry when life sent him some curveballs that resulted in him going into the military, because I just didn't think it was a good fit for Sean. And about 4 years ago, I read on his Facebook posts that kind of worried me, but I didn't get very concerned until his Facebook went totally quiet. Then Sean's wife posted that he had taken his own life after leaving the military. What he had seen and what he had experienced tormented him to the place where he could not and did not want to live. Innocence about war and its impact, totally destroyed. Decades ago, there was a movie called Network, and in it, a broadcaster just reaches his limit and goes off script and says something like, "I'm damn tired of it all, and I'm just not going to take it anymore." I forget who the actor was, but it was a very powerful scene. Because he said, again, to the character in the movie, "If you feel the same way I do, open your windows, open your doors, and say it with me. I am tired of it all, and I'm not going to take it anymore." You get the picture, right? Well, that's the way I feel. Little meek and mild me, that's the way I feel about the senseless violence, and that's the way I feel about war. I am so tired and angry and upset about the senseless loss of life. Either through war or through the mass shootings, I am tired of it all, and it's got to stop somehow, some way. There needs to be a sensible resolution to gun violence. And it seems to me if you can end a war with negotiation at a table, well, why the heck don't you start with negotiation? To me, that's logic. You cut out all the middle stuff about people hurting and families being destroyed and societies and cultures being disrupted and the earth being harmed. To me, this is logical. War is illogical. Gun violence is irrational, and it's got to stop. Now, the third point of my remarks today is celebrating people who are taking action about the things that I am feeling. And that is the role that artists among us play in helping to convey the anger, the frustration, sometimes the rage, or the resolve, or the mourning, or the need for solidarity, or highlighting the solidarity that exists already. How artists can convey in visual images, like pictures or photographs or comics or cartoons. How musicians and lyricists and composers and performers can use instruments, tonality, words to take us to a different place and to convey what is difficult for us to share and express. And they've been doing it for centuries. Go back to the time of Jean Sibelius and the writing of Finlandia. Did you know that it was not allowed for that piece to be performed for a period of time? It was too radical. It was too national. No. But here today, we have Finlandia as the tune for one of the tunes in our hymnal. So clearly, that law has gone away. Ludwig van Beethoven's Symphony No. 3 is a piece of resistance against the powers at that time that he was living. Giuseppe Verdi's opera, Nabucco, has in it the chorus of Hebrew slaves and the translation of what they are singing, "Oh, my country, so beautiful and lost." Imagine that, slaves singing about the country they've lost. Luigi Nono wrote the opera Intolleranza. In it, he attacks fascism, the atomic bomb, and segregation, ending with a biblical style of flood which wipes the world clean. Not a happy ending, mind you, but definitely an ending to injustice. Every style of music, of popular music, and even those that are, go back a bit further, has had its say in protest in some form or another. Consider the call response style of the African American spirituals. And then you have the art forms of today, the music videos that are so very popular. It all has the opportunity to stir our hearts, to bring emotions to a peak, and hopefully to call us to civil engagement, to translate those feelings we have and challenge us into positive action. Let me give you some examples of songs that have been part of protests in their day. Yankee Doodle, John Brown's Body. This one's a little bit before my time. Strange Fruit by Billie Holiday. That one was about Southern lynchings. Many of you know the song This Land Is Your Land by Woody Guthrie, but I bet there are some among you that don't know the last verses, which really speak to the dichotomy, those who have and those who don't. Unfortunately, what Woody was writing about and singing about still is with us today, and a lot of times when that piece is performed, those verses are dropped. So you have to look it up to find out what I'm saying. Today we had Blown in the Wind by Bob Dylan. He also is famous for his Times They Are A-Changin'. Now he said he didn't write them as protest songs, but they were co-opted by the peace and civil rights movements as freedom songs. Tamara Roberts is an ethnomusicologist at University of California, Berkeley. And she says that these freedom songs were especially powerful because they came out of the Black church tradition, out of a shared body of song and already had a history. Artists making these songs helped galvanize the backside of the civil rights movement, giving activists a new way to express both hope and frustration. Some of you may remember Sam Cooke's Change Is Gonna Come from 1964. That was a track that expressed less of the anger and a more melancholy hopefulness. Kelly today shared with you the lyrics of What's Going On by Marvin Gaye. That was an early 1970s protest song, and you know what? It could be applied today for any number of grievances. In the 80s, we had rap music getting involved, and many of those artists were going mainstream, offering up indictments of police brutality, or fighting the order of the day, or raging against the machine, raging against colonization of the Americas, or even atomic bombs in World War II. In 2006, we had Neil Young singing Let's Impeach the President. Sage Francis, that was a man before his time. No, Sage Francis, the rapper, released Makeshift Patriot, critiquing the media coverage of 9/11. The post-9/11 era music was a little quiet, had little pockets of anger, but nothing that was a continuous protest or movement-based. That is until you get to 2011 with Lady Gaga, Born This Way, about queer acceptance. And then you have Kendrick Lamar's All Right, which became the unofficial anthem of the Black Lives Matter movement. Beyoncé brought feminism and music to the mainstream in 2014 with Flawless. There are many, many more examples in popular music across all genres. Well, there's one genre I haven't talked about, and that is jazz. In my opinion, jazz is in and of itself a protest. A protest against all the established rules of how music ought to be written or performed. Let's change that chord pattern. Let's put in a little sharper flat there. No, I want a diminished seventh. Okay, all right. I don't want to sing words, I want to sing syllables. Okay, a little bit of scat. That's fine, that's cool. Hey, you know what? You just go ahead and riff off on the key of G and we'll meet you 8 measures later. That's jazz, ever evolving, ever expressing what the individuals who are playing it have to say that day, that time. And it's wonderful, in my opinion. You have songs from the 60s and 70s coming back because some fundamental issues have not been solved and things haven't changed, or they've only changed incrementally. When you look or think about a change is going to come, it's still an anthem today. Dr. Roberts puts it this way: I think now we have a need for songs that can be just shared by whoever shows up and quickly learned, and that can be part of sustaining protests or compelling people to be in protest for longer periods. Whatever, I'm just grateful for those who bring music to us, people who write the music, people who perform the music, that help convey feelings of resistance, of power, of rage, of anger and frustration, who help me channel all of the things that I can't necessarily act upon, but through music I can let it out. I continue to have questions like, when will it end? When will this end? When will the senseless violence end? And the answer, so they tell me, is blown in the wind. Ever elusive? Or perhaps, is the answer with you, within you and me, and then what we can do together? Peace.
The Crossroads.
And this is a brand new song about how a little neighborhood Cayley, or a music and dance party in Ireland, ultimately helped lead into the Good Friday Peace Accords, which ended, depending on how you look at it, either 30-something or 800-plus years of sectarian violence. In one sense, the song is celebrating the power of music to bring people together. But at a deeper level, it's about the importance of human connections in whatever form they take for overcoming dehumanization. And this will be the first public performance of this piece. I was changing things up until about 1 a.m. on Saturday morning. Don't worry, I was only changing some prepositions at that point. And the lyrics are up here, so if the spirit so moves you, please join in. Troubles shrouded Ireland, but not the Ryan Road, where lamps lit up the windows of the Crossroads Cayley home, where neighbors crossed the borderlands to Tommy Sands's door, and who was meant to hate just who, he never was quite sure. So rising up your bows, it's music of the crossroads, and the music goes where music goes. There's not a border that it knows, it's made by one and all. It's music of the crossroads that makes a song from many notes, that holds a place for many hopes, that's made by one and all, and made for one and all. Peace along that stretch of fields could only be a start, with those who'd never heard the music prowling through the dark. And Tommy swore when strangers came to strike the Ryan Road, he'd bring the peace the Cayley brought across the radio. Hear how the peace would grow, it's music of the crossroads, and the music goes where music goes. There's not a border that it knows, it's made by one and all. It's music of the crossroads that makes a song from many notes, that holds a place for many hopes, that's made by one and all, and made for one and all. So if you tuned in Saturdays above the walls and wires, you'd hear the songs in chorus from a most peculiar choir. For Tommy brought on provost and the Ulster volunteers. First they came on separately, then how the change appeared. Songs till the rooster crows, it's music of the crossroads. And the music goes where music goes, there's not a border that it knows. It's made by one and all. It's music of the crossroads that makes a song from many notes, that holds a place for many hopes, that's made by one and all, and made for one and all. And peace talks came but couldn't close, so Tommy called his band of scores of former militants who marched out hand in hand to burst the walls in Parliament with fife and pipe and drum. They sang the peace they knew could be, and singing made it come. The MPs tell us so, it's music of the crossroads. And the music goes where music goes, there's not a border that it knows. It's made by one and all. It's music of the crossroads that makes a song from many notes, that holds a place for many hopes, that's made by one and all, and made for one and all. It's music of the crossroads.
Our church operation and community outreach depend on your support and contributions. This is a perfect time to think about giving as much as you can. The greeters will pass among you in a moment with the offering baskets. I'd like to remind you also that our church supports a different group each quarter, and we call this Change for Change. That means you can put change in the basket, or you can write a check or put money in the envelope and say, this is for change, for change. This quarter, our recipient is the Border Servant Corps. I was reading about them and I didn't realize, right here in Las Cruces, in one year, they have helped over 32,000 immigrants find sponsors. So they're doing a great job. During the offertory, our wonderful band will play Canto Libre.
Soy es un paloma que buscando en anidar está ya y se abre los alas para volar y volar.
Mi canto es un canto libre que se quiere quien le estrecha su mano, a quien quiera disparar. Mi canto es un canto libre.
Canto es un canto libre.
Mi canto es una cadena sin comienzo ni final. En cada eslabón se encuentra el canto de los demás, el canto de los demás. Sigamos cantando juntos a toda la humanidad, que el verso eso es una paloma que vuela para encontrar. Estalla y abre sus alas para volar y volar. Mi canto es un canto libre.
Our closing hymn this time is one you all know, If I Had a Hammer. May we sing along?
Oh, absolutely. Okay. I think you must.
Body or spirit?
Yes.
And I imagine many of you know this one, but as folk songs do, this one has changed a little bit. You might notice that the fourth line in this particular rendition is no longer hammer out love between my brothers and my sisters. It's hammer out love between every living being all over this land.
If I had a hammer, I'd hammer in the morning. I'd hammer in the evening all over this land. I'd hammer out danger. I'd hammer out a warning. I'd hammer out love between every living being all over this land. If I had a song bell, I'd ring it in the morning. I'd ring it in the evening all over this land. I'd ring out I'd ring out a warning. I'd ring out love between every living being all over this land. If I had a song, I'd sing it in the morning. I'd sing it in the evening all over this land. I'd sing out danger, I'd sing out a warning, I'd sing out love between every living being all over this land. Well, I've got a hammer, and I've got a bell, and I've got a song to sing all over this land. It's the hammer of justice. It's the bell of freedom. It's a song about love between every living being all over this land. All over this land.
Our closing words today are from Reverend Landrum, who is a minister in Massachusetts. We leave this gathered community, but we don't leave our connection, our concerns, or our care for each other, our service to each other, to the world, or to our faith, and our faith continues until we are together again, friends. Be strong, be well, be true. Be loving. As we extinguish the flame, please join me and we say these words.
Extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of commitment, or the fire of commitment. These we carry in our hearts until we are together again.
Our postlude is from Old Time Pharmaceuticals called Joan and Victor Hara, or Jara. And then don't forget refreshments down the hall.
Our offertory hymn, Canto Libre, was written by Victor Jara, who did in Chile much of what Pete Seeger did here in the U.S. And the song is, in one sense, about the end of Victor's life, but also about its continuation. And it can sometimes be hard to see how change can happen, but it does. It does.
Once I had a kind young man, husband and lover. Once I had a kind young man, a long time ago. Santiago's fearless singer, and Lord, I loved him so. Songs and silence his singing. Then they came to still that voice of hope and of peace. But in the night I'd crossed the border and his music was with me. Song will outlive the singer. seed, and all the world from Tyre to Belfast will hear my victor sing.
And after the events in that song, after Joan Jara smuggled the master tracks of her murdered husband's music out of the country, she came back to Chile while Pinochet was still in power. And over 17 years, using partially Victor's music, helped lead the ultimately successful pro-democracy movement. She still lives in Santiago, Chile, and now runs the Victor Jara Foundation, where every cent of that song's revenue, of course, directly goes. But if she and a Victor could make the change through all of the horrible things during the Pinochet regime in Chile and all of the struggles for justice beforehand, surely we can do much the same in our country. Let's go see what we can do.